人权理事会有一些工具或机制来完成它的主要任务，就是在全世界保护和推动人权。现在我们看一下其中的一个关键的机制，普遍定期审议。那它是什么呢？人权捍卫者怎么使用它呢？
When the UN made the transition from a Human Rights Commission to the Council, they made a number ofadjustments in the process. And probably the most significant was the introduction of this universal periodic review, which applies to every member state and requires a periodic review of their human rights records.
If you had said to me 8 years ago that states will voluntarily present their human rights report in public to a UN body, the Human Rights Council, that NGOs have space there. NGOs also provide their alternate report, and also the High Commissioner does the human rights report for every country. So it's important that NGOs, A, access these mechanisms. So let me highlight them. Firstly, the High Commissioner's office, because High Commissioner for Human Rights prepares the report. We need the information to balance what the state claims they have done. Now, this is a process called the UPR, which is a Universal Periodic Review, and this is where the counter reports or shadow reports could be filed.
各国的审议是有周期性的，每个国家每四年半审议一次，每年有三次普遍定期审议的会期，分别是在一月、四月、十月、十一月之交。审议基于的主要文件包括被审议国家的报告，过去四年中所有联合国官方报告的汇编，公民社会自愿的或平行的报告。审议本身持续3到4个小时，地点是在联合国万国宫人权理事会开会的地方。期间，联合国各成员国不论是不是理事会成员，都会对被审议国在如何改进人权记录方面提出建议，然后被审议国可以选择是否接受。非政府组织可以参与普遍定期审议的整个过程，既有正式方式，也有非正式方式。比如说，各国起草国家报告时，应该和公民社会合作，不过当然，很多时候做不到这一点。所以公民社会可以递交自己给普遍定期审议的报告，递交报告不需要联合国的许可，但是要注意截止日期。
The process for submitting information as an NGO is very straightforward. There's simply an email address to which one can send a short summary of the human rights concerns that the NGO or the individual has in the country concerned. They're encouraged to submit information which is succinct, so it doesn't need to be a lengthy 40-page brief or anything like that. It can be, I think, up to 5 pages is how much we're allowed to submit by way of information. But it can be less than that as well. I often say to people, you know, if you can send an email, you can submit information to the UPR, and it can be just a few paragraphs that identify what some of the key concerns that you have that you want states to raise. It's important also to make sure that any information you do submit concludes with short recommendations that you encourage other governments to raise with your country, so that in addition to highlighting the human rights situation, there are specific proposals for change. But I think one of the challenges about engaging with the UN generally is that it's often seen as a big, inaccessible body, and a lot of people don't know how to engage or what are the tools and how to use them. But in fact, a lot of it, you know, can be demystified, and once you know your way around the system, it can be quite straightforward.
Before each session of the UPR, civil society can, if possible, come to Geneva and participate in what are called pre-sessional meetings. These are opportunities for national and international civil society defenders, national human rights institutions, and diplomats to come together and to discuss priority recommendations. During the review itself, then, the governments hopefully will be able to take what they've heard and use that to inform the recommendations that they make, ensuring that they are measurable and concrete and will make change on the ground. on the sidelines of the review, civil society also has an opportunity to host side events, which help to draw a little bit more media attention and maybe generate some leverage to make sure that the state under review actually accepts the priority recommendations.
普遍定期审议是公民社会参与人权理事会的一个重要机制，但是有用吗？
因为在和不同的群体在一起工作的时候，我们都认识到，其实我们要去尝试不同的渠道，去让外界了解中国的人权状况，让外界能够帮助中国的人权捍卫者去改变中国的人权状况。基于这样的原因，我觉得我们应该了解UN 这一套体系，然后应该利用 UN 的这一套体系来为中国的状况服务。
The UPR process is basically two steps. The UPR review occurs, and then the UPR report is adopted. And that's the point where governments say which recommendations they've accepted. Civil society and human rights defenders can and should absolutely engage throughout that process. They can use recommendations to make sure that they're benchmarking the government's progress and implementation. They can also encourage their governments to draft what are called midterm reports. These are voluntary, so governments don't need to do them, but it's often a good mechanism to use to make sure that the government itself is keeping in mind the obligations that it's undertaken to implement certain changes in their human rights record. Even if the government chooses not to write a midterm report, civil society can continue to monitor, continue to track how the government is doing moving forward, submitting their own reports, whether to other governments to encourage some more pressure or to the UN. So I think through basically all stages of the process, from writing the report to conducting the advocacy to making sure that follow-up is being monitored and tracked, NGOs have a really crucial role to play in making the UPR have an impact on the ground.
现在我们来总结一下，普遍定期审议这一机制让所有联合国成员国的人权状况受到人权理事会的审查。公民社会可以在审议过程中的几个阶段以不同方式参与，通过编写报告、会议前进行倡导、监督建议的落实，非政府组织可以发挥重要作用，使普遍定期审议真正的在地面上有所影响。联合国和非政府组织的网站上有很多资料可以查阅。